Hello, and a very warm welcome to the Insider Essay, your guide to living better. Join us today as we open up to Pride and Progress, filming the latest music video from the Ndlovu Youth Choir's new album, Grateful, featuring Sun L musician and 25K, Sidney Tobias, son of Springbok legend Errol Tobias, joins Kurt-Lee Arendse as the new Pride of Loftus. TikToker Moghelingz is the out and proud face of how far South Africa's come. Entrepreneur and changemaker Lerai aims to leave no woman behind. Miss Teen Universe runner-up Ntando Sgudla walks the talk on the progress of young women. And Semi Lubisi's charcoal portraits of life in Ivory Park are art by, for, and of the people. He began creating comedy sketches to get through lockdown. Now 19 and a TikTok star with 1.3 million followers, he is outwardly proudly young, African, and loved across the continent.
Oh, hi everyone. My name is Mbalele Ndaba, but you can call me Moghelingz, and I am an award-winning social media content creator, and welcome to my world. I grew up in a very small town called Standerton. I grew up around a lot of people, man, my friends, family, neighbors, and all of that. So it really influenced me in a lot of ways because obviously I grew up in an era where there wasn't social media by that time. And half of the time I would spend my time on the streets playing with friends, you know? So just growing around all of that really influenced me to actually become this strong person that I am. And yeah, man, growing up from Kasi actually taught me how to grow a thick skin, and I think it helped because it made the person that I am today. So I moved to Joburg in 2022, which was this year, early January, and that was when I was getting a lot of gigs that and events I needed to attend that were happening here in Joburg. So it was actually hard for me to travel from Mpumalanga to Joburg each and every weekend, basically. So I spoke to my family about it, and I actually came this side, and it really, really changed a lot because it was a hard transition from coming back from a very small town and coming to a big town like Johannesburg.
What drove Banele was the thought of changing his family's situation to a better life. And he was going to need determination.
So I started content creation in 2017, officially. Before I created comedy content, I was doing dance and also music. So I used to sing on social media, you know, because I've always been in the school choir. So I thought, nah, man, let me just try something out. Let me just put my phone there and make YouTube videos and just, you know. And it didn't work out up until I fell in love with comedy, because I really looked up to a lot of comedians here in South Africa and also abroad. But officially, I started joining TikTok in 2020. That's when I took my content creation seriously. There wasn't much traffic that was happening, you know, on my social media account. It was just me being passionate and just the love for camera and the love for entertaining people, making people laugh, you know. I was doing it for that, just for the sake of entertaining. But I kept going, you know. I would get those 3 views, 10 views, and it was something at that time to say, oh, actually, someone is enjoying your content, you know. And yeah, one thing about me, I'm persistent, so I think that is what led me to this point now.
It was his late grandmother he learned the most from, and he honors her in a unique way.
So this gown is very special to me because it was my grandma's favorite gown. Ever since she passed away, I've just taken it as her token of appreciation, and yeah, I just use it all the time. That's why I actually liked this gown a lot when I started content creation, was that I think it was a strategy for me to actually catch people's attention, you know, because obviously I wasn't well known that time, and Moghelingz wasn't just a name that they can always remember. So I was like, let me just wear something that will actually catch people's attention. So every time I post, I wear this gown, so like, oh, it's the guy with the blue gown, you know.
Another persona which Moghelingz's hundreds of thousands of Instagram followers love is his sporty one.
This is my netball outfit that I used for my netball skits. And the reason why I cross-dress is because costume plays a lot of part of my content creative process. For me to look a certain character, I have to wear that character, you know, just so it can be believable to the audience as to what I'm trying to portray or what story am I trying to tell. So for me to get my message across, I obviously have to look that character. So I would say costume plays a lot in my creating process. So the reason why I think people resonate with me is that I create relatable content. With every video that I do, I just try to actually take people back as to where we grew up, you know, the Gassi, because I really like to stand up for Gassi kids, you know, and I don't try to sugarcoat things or try to be like someone else for social media. I just put things as they are. I think my sense of style is very different from Moghelingz, because I'm very shy, I'm very down to earth, I'm very calm. So I can say that Moghelingz is an alter ego, which Banele uses to actually get to places where he can't reach. With content creation, it's not just being on camera, you know, it's all about storytelling. So it's really important for people to relate to what you're saying and to actually grasp or learn something from whatever message that you're trying to get across.
Unable to study after matric because of financial constraints, Banele is now saving to take himself to varsity while entertaining all the way.
I think getting a thumbs up from people in the industry really does pressures me a lot. So just getting that validation from them as to you're doing a great job, just keep on going. And it's so heartwarming. It's really heartwarming to see such people that I look up to actually saying, kid, you're doing good, you know? And recently I just won Content Creator of the Year at the Cloud Africa Awards. It was such a big movement for me. It was my first ever nomination, award nomination, and I won it. And to think the competition that I had was people from Ghana, Nigeria, basically the whole of Africa. It was such a big moment for me, and I'm really grateful for it.
As for a legacy, Moghelingz wants his fellow youth to be fearless but kind. Do what the world says you can't, and make your own rules. Coming up, Semi Lubisi's portraits make Ivory Park so proud. And entrepreneur Lerai lives better by helping others. Sponsored by Capitec. Simplify banking. Live better. In Semi Lubisi's early years, he spent many proud weekends with his carpenter father fixing shacks, learning to use his hands and ingenuity. As he grew up, those skills progressed in a creative direction, into a career as an artist.
I grew up here in Ivory Park. Most of my artworks are inspired by everyday lives of the people in the township. As you can see, there's kids playing in here. And there is so much business that's happening. I used to draw on my school books, so teachers there would see that I have actually a talent in drawing. And then they would encourage me to say, keep on drawing, don't get discouraged. And they would recommend me to get some books that I can actually learn from.
That he did, and when we visited, he was busy with new pieces for the hashtag Open Studios Joburg exhibition and commissioned work for his clients.
This is my studio where I get to put in those ideas and sentiments and feelings into paper or into canvas, and by making use of acrylics and charcoals, watercolors, and a bit of collage in there to translate those feelings. This is actually an art building. It accommodates artists that use different kinds of practice. We have people who do sculptures, people who do printing, people who do paint, we have fashion designers. So the entire building itself, it's strictly for artists. I use charcoal especially to sketch, because to me this is like advanced version of the pencil. So it allows me the flexibility to actually sketch and actually being able to tone and give shade to the artwork. Yeah, I think when the inspiration just comes, I just respond to it. There is some kind of higher power or energy that actually drives this thing into me, and then I just project it, I just take it out. And then have an idea in terms of the image that I want to project or the message that I want to tell. The bright colors is a way of actually bringing light and happiness into the pictures that I do. Most of the time I use children to express emotions or ideas with my artworks. The reason why I like to use children is because children are more free-spirited. They are innocent. Irrespective of the circumstances that are happening around them, they still project that hope, that desire, and that presence, that energy that's so filled with so much. And by using them, I can express a lot of emotions, a lot of ideas. Hence, whenever I'm working with children, whenever I'm doing a child painting or drawing, it takes me back to that time when I was at a happy place, playing in there, you know, being so happy, not worry about all those other things. I want a person from the township to be able to see my work and actually recognize it. So it has to actually first speak to the people who I'm representing. And I want that person to actually feel it and see it as the way of life. On this piece in here, there is kids playing soccer. And it's also to say that there is great talent in the township. Because if you look, most of the superstars, they come from disadvantaged environments. It is just to say there is talent here in the township. So we should be able to invest more time in developing talent whenever we see potential. The idea here is that of love, that of togetherness of the kids in the township. That's actually how we grew up. On this piece's inspiration behind it is the priceless moments, the things that we sometimes take for granted. If you look at it, there is houses in here, which is the township houses, and there is life in here. I'm trying to say appreciate life, irrespective of where you come from. And if you look at her, she's happy and she's eating a sweet, which is shaped in her art form, which expresses love. This one in here, it's about a sisterhood, similar to the painting that I did that side. So I'm trying to express the message that says women are stronger together. If they love each other and they hold on into each other, they can actually achieve great things. On this collage, there's a message that reads Sister Love, which is actually the title of the artwork. My message to the township kids is actually to believe in their dreams, pursue their dreams, and not get demotivated by people who actually are going to try to bring you down or demotivate you. Believe in something, work hard for it, and if you're passionate about it, eventually that dream will come true.
Semi's son, Kanya, is his daily motivation, and his faith in our youth is unshakable. Image sells for a day. Talent needs direction. And ideas only impact the world if there's a solid plan behind them. At just 19, one South African woman has already learned these lessons and is motivating other young people to think big, work hard, and make a difference.
Hey, Insider SA, my name is Lerai, and welcome to my home and my world. I'm a creative entrepreneur, a social change maker, and a conversation strategist. And basically, I aspire to be a strong female voice in Africa who really seeks to impact change, specifically in youth empowerment as well as women empowerment. Because I am a full-time student and I basically work full-time, it's difficult to balance both of those lives because when I'm at school, I am rushing to hand in assignments and then I have a test and then I have a class that I have to go to on campus. And then there will be days where I have to do both. So I'll take some classes in the morning and then rush to studio to film whatever we're filming. But it's fun. I feel fulfilled as a human being when I'm productive.
Lerai has learned a wealth of practical wisdom from her business partner and mother, Jessica Narai Tandi, and they shared a few insights from their experience.
I am a co-owner and co-director of African Talent Unearthed, ATU for short. And really, we seek to facilitate the convergence of authentic African talent with global opportunity, but also equipping people with entrepreneurial skills.
Being a mother of a creative and also being an entrepreneur myself, the idea was to teach her how to be an entrepreneur. And then for me, the best way of teaching her was that she sees me doing something practically. And that's how it started.
We don't see talent as merely a source of entertainment, but we want to capitalize on its capacity to be a vehicle for nation building and self-development, because that's really what talent and entertainment is.
Now, this was super exciting.
As a mom raising a girl child in this world, it was quite important that I begin with an end in mind, because I could see that it's always been something that scares her a lot to say, where are you in 3 years? Where are you in 5 years? And in doing the end in mind, without having the details, you get to have an understanding that I need to be somewhere there, and therefore, what are the plans and the steps that I need to put in place into getting there?
A money plan serves as a detailed map that shows you exactly where to spend your money, where to save, and for how long.
I used to think, I've got a lot of money in the bank account. And then when I looked at what all the expenses were, I was like, I'm actually broke as a human being, because life has so many expenses and all of that. But what it helped me was planning financially. And I realized that when you plan financially, you're able to plan your life. I have aspirations of traveling the world. I have aspirations of being financially independent. But doing all of those things means making the savings.
We came across an article, which was a Capitec article, remember? When it talks about financial planning, it was a nice practical way of saying, take your goals, and how do you then take your goals into the practicalities? And we sat down, did the budgeting based on the article and how it was guiding us.
Capitec provides tools, assistance, and inspiration, like through articles. I read the one on the one-year plan for your financial goals, and really, for me, it puts into perspective how I need to do all of this, from short-term to medium-term to long-term. And so when I started at the beginning of the year budgeting my entire life, I had this tool that really helped me do it and crunch it down into pieces and essentially come up with a budget and a financial plan.
It's allowing Lerai to live better each day, like taking an afternoon with friend Mpo Nkwango at the Y Cook studio of Matapelo Muntu.
Welcome. So, Pops, you'll be doing some lamb chops, but with a spin, some citrus into it. And then you'll be making some malva pudding. Once it's in the oven, it's going to be amazing. And we're going to put in some evaporated milk and then custard.
Listen, this is my playground. I know what I'm doing. I'm ready.
I am trusting you on this.
When I was younger, I looked for a place to express myself creatively at home, and I found that love in the kitchen. I loved the process of creating something from start to finish, and then the look on my parents' faces when they actually enjoy what I've created. So it became my love language as well. 1000 Girls was a campaign that we started at the peak of lockdown, at the beginning of it. My friends and I weren't allowed to go to school anymore, no social interactions. And so we were interacting with each other virtually. And we said, what can we do to help? And we identified refugees as people in need. So we put our heads together. We said, how can we tap into our resources? And I can happily say that a year later, we successfully raised funds for 1,000 sanitary and hygiene packages for refugee women and children in Johannesburg.
What I really admire the most about Lerai is probably her ability to just focus. She's also very loving, very, very loving. And with that love, she was able to show me a different side to South Africa with 1000 Girls. She was able to bring me into her heart and say, you know what, let's try to do this together. Let's try make a difference together.
Understanding the meaning of a life well lived this early in your career is such a head start.
My final piece of advice for young people especially is to find that point where your passion and your purpose meet. Once you have that convergence, Only beautiful things can happen, especially when you put the right planning into place, short term, medium term, and long term.
Living life to the fullest with a vision and plan for getting there, while practically committing to leave no one behind. That's how our youth will progress. Tell us your plan for how to live better and stand a chance to win R1,000. Simply reply to the competition post on the Insider Essay's social media platforms using hashtag LiveBetter. T's and C's apply and can be found on the Insider Essay website. Right after this, Kurt-Lee Arendse, Sidney Tobias and the men from Loftus book their place in Rugby's Champions Cup. Loftus Versfeld has seen the growth of a friendship between two players at different stages in their careers. After a time away from first-class rugby, 33-year-old Sidney Tobias was called on to beef up the union's forwards, while at 25, his friend is fast becoming a new local hero.
Hey, I'm Kurt-Lee Arendse, and I play for the Vodacom Bulls. I'm an outside back, welcome to my turf. So I started playing rugby at the age of 8 years old, played my first game for my primary school, Polo Joubert. After that game, I decided this is what I want to do when I grow up, and I'm still enjoying playing rugby. I got the call up for the Sevens Academy, and from there onwards, my journey started with the Sevens. So I got the opportunity to join the Bulls on a loan. I mean, there's a lot of history on this field. I mean, guys like Swiss van der Westhuizen and Mone Steyn, for Edipri playing on this field, and now it's just amazing falling in those guys' footsteps. So yeah, it's just incredible.
In terms of leveling the playing field, South African rugby has made more progress in 4 years than in all the prior 40.
Hi, I'm Sidney Tobias, and I play hooker for the Vodacom Bulls. So my love of rugby started from a young age. My dad was the first player of color to play for South Africa for the Springboks, Errol Tobias. When I was old enough to understand the ins and the outs of rugby, obviously that love grew when I went to a big school like Paul Roos, and from there I played for Western Province, and I've been in England and Italy and currently plying my trade here at the Vodacom Bulls. So last year when I got invited, it's actually when my relationship started with Kurt-Lee. You know, he was one of the first guys to like open up to me and be friendly in that way. And from there, our relationship actually grew. I consider him one of my closest friends now. You know, his positivity is something that just draws you closer to him. And it's encouraging to see one of the younger players being so grounded and humble. Obviously, there's a lot of stuff that is required of you when you're a professional rugby player. You know, you have to look after your nutrition, you've got to look after your body, you've got to make sure you sleep enough, you've got to do mental preparation. There's a lot of work that goes in behind the scenes when you're a professional player. Also, it helps when you're in a professional environment.
So Sidney and I, we jump together. Especially on the off days, we come into the gym and do a bit of extras. He always push me to the next level, and he's a great friend of mine. First we're gonna do leg extensions. It helps me get over the advantage line, especially when I play against bigger guys. And the next thing is we're gonna do the explosive machine. It helps getting beat your man, especially on the field. And then the sledge is just to improve your speed. Our exercise routine on a Monday looks like we will do a flush out. Tuesdays, we will do a men up or a tempo session. And then Wednesdays, we're off. Thursdays, we will do another men up session. And then if we play on Friday, we will prepare for the game. Or if we play on Saturday, then we will do a captains on Friday, and then we'll play on Saturday.
Before his recall to pro rugby, Sidney was doing 10-hour shifts down a mine, becoming a rock engineer. So a reflexology session was so welcome.
I think the importance of downtime can't be underestimated, because at the end of the day, all we have is our bodies. We use it as a tool. So for us, getting treatments like this is of the utmost importance.
I must say the foot massage is really amazing. It's making me relaxed and calm at the same time. So yeah, I'm really enjoying it with Sidney.
To a man who scrums for a living, there is no better form of spoiling.
This back massage is absolutely amazing. I mean, this is next level. This is the ultimate source of just relaxation and just being calm and giving your body what it needs. I think what's quite unique about Kurt-Lee as a human being is his mentality. He's got a one-of-a-kind mentality, and he's you know, he's always consistently positive, and he only speaks good things and sees himself doing good, not in a vain type of way or that he's self-conceited, but more of a place of absolute belief in himself.
Kurt knows his pal as a man with much confidence in his cooking skills. But whether Sidney can make a fine coffee was a debate to settle at Wayne Vermeulen's hip new cafe, Noosh.
Now, I must say, this is a beautiful place we have here, and I hope the coffee is as beautiful as it looks. Yeah.
No, but Kurt, I heard he roasts his own coffee, and I think that's time for us to have a little competition there. I want to smash you.
I'm ready for the challenge.
Let's go. Great, guys. Let's go in.
Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, John.
I'm going to show you how to make some cappuccinos. I'll pre-dose my milk, heat my cup, dose my shot, then I froth the milk, then you pour the cappuccino.
Well done.
It's a picture of the Earth from outer space.
Since switching from wing to fullback, Kurt-Lee has been a revelation. His coffee, not so much.
Let's see if Kurt-Lee has BMT.
Yes! Mine looks better than us.
No, there's no foam or froth.
Yeah, wow, man.
Doesn't look too bad, Curtis. What were you going for here?
Yes, eh? It almost looks like a cloud.
I can't see it, this is abstract art.
It looks like a bicycle, mate.
it does look like a bicycle, eh?
Sure.
Better foam temperature, more or less the same, so which one is better?
Ah, go for this.
Thank you, John.
Well done. Well done.
Thanks, Wayne.
Wow.
Well done.
When it comes to what the guys can eat, they're on different planets.
We don't follow a strict diet. We're just working hard and enjoy whatever food we can eat. And yeah.
I think what Kurt-Lee is saying is actually more applicable to the backline players. But the tighties and all the forwards need to look what they actually consume. And we try and limit the calorie intake. But we're not so much genetically blessed as most of the backs are.
My first few months coming to Pretoria, I was quite confused, especially about the weather. But now I'm actually enjoying Pretoria, but sometimes I miss the beach of Cape Town. But really, it's been challenging to move to Pretoria from Cape Town.
I'm blessed to have been married for 7 years now. We've got a four-year-old daughter that actually loves rugby and most of all, she loves Kurt-Lee. Uncle Kurt-Lee is a favorite rugby player or a favorite person. You know, having a family is such a, I think it's the biggest blessing that you can ever have. And it gives you a purpose in life for whatever you want to do. It's not always about yourself, but you know, family is always probably the most important reason.
In that case, Imogen Marais challenged the gents to say it with a flower arrangement.
Certainly, I think I'll definitely beat you on this.
Are you trying to make up for the coffee?
Yeah, no, definitely.
Loss?
I'm ready.
Okay, let's go.
Look at the yellow
go.
Flowers, it looks beautiful.
There's not a right or a wrong of compiling about.
So no winners, Kurt-Lee.
You can just relax. What you normally do, you need a focus point with a bigger flower, and then we do some fillers, and then we will take some of the greenery around it, and then we can bunch it. I like the contrast here, but the roses we can lift a little bit more. We need also what gives it a nice flair is this grass.
Wow.
So we can put it like over here.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
And now we're gonna bunch it.
Looks pretty.
So now what you do to make it more sturdy, you just fasten it.
Yeah, no, I must say it was good to arrange the flowers and to see the end product looks absolutely amazing. I made the flowers for my mother. She definitely deserves this flower. She's a beautiful lady and I think she'll appreciate it.
And my flowers, I'm still deciding either my wife or my little daughter. I think the wife is gonna get these spoils today.
You have a feeling for flowers, definitely.
Is it? Is this more or less the same as like with the coffee?
Yeah.
So in the rest of my career, I would just want to enjoy the game as much as possible and try and give back a little bit more to the younger generation coming through. It's, for me, it's purely enjoyment and enjoying what's left.
In my career, I'm really looking forward to just to grow as a person and hopefully one day I can play for the Springboks and yeah, just enjoy my rugby.
Even better than flowers would be bringing us all home championship silverware from the United Rugby Championship in Europe. Just ahead, meet Ntando Sgudla, sports ambassador, student, top achiever, and Miss Teen Universe First Princess. What 18-year-old pageant winner, University of Pretoria student and influencer Ntando Sgudla is already achieving in her teens is a picture of how much progress is possible within a generation.
Hi guys, my name is Ntando Sgudla, your Miss Teen Universe South Africa 2021 and your Miss Teen Universe 2022 first runner-up. Welcome to my home. Come in. I grew up in such a very loving household, a Christian household. I was raised in the church. I grew up playing lots of sports, every sport under the sun. I even dabbled in gymnastics and started to do a bit of dance. I loved sports so much that I became a bit of a tomboy. I shaved all of my hair off. Never in a million years did I think I would be even into pageantry and dressing up and modeling at all. I was in high school and I was at a sleepover and my mom gave me a phone call to say, hey, by the way, I entered you into a pageant. And I was actually quite shocked. I didn't even know what to feel. I didn't know how to process it. But you know, I've always done different things that put me out of my comfort zone. So I said, hey, let me just try it out. Let me see. Maybe this could be something that I'd also be passionate about. It takes serious focus and determination and a lot of sacrifices to win a pageant or to even do well or place at a pageant in the first place. So I had to really do a lot of hard work. I had to sacrifice my social life and I had to learn how to balance school and pageantry because I was in matric and there was no time for fun, there was no time for games. If this was something that I was so serious about, I was going to do everything and anything to win the title, and that's what I did.
Followed by the step up to Miss Teen Universe while studying a town and regional planning degree.
One of the biggest reasons why I wanted to win Miss Teen Universe South Africa is because the winner would be given the incredible opportunity of a lifetime to compete internationally in Dubai. So I was ecstatic when I won, which meant I would finally be able to live out my dream of wearing South Africa over my chest and representing South Africa internationally. It was quite a bit of a journey to get there, from looking for sponsors to getting the right outfits to wear. And me and my mom were adamant to make this dream of mine come true.
Single parent Jabulile Sangweni always reminds her three children that their choices define their future.
My mom has been absolutely instrumental in just even the progression of my career in pageantry. She has really just pushed me to be everything and more. I think a lot of people don't have the support of their parents in their passions or in their dreams. And honestly, it even makes me emotional sometimes to think about how my mom has supported me.
The reason I entered her first pageant is because I saw the potential in her. You know, as a child growing up, when we are watching Miss South Africa, she would go to my wardrobe and take my shoes and wear them and walk in the passage. then I could see that she also loved this pageant thing. She's very intelligent. She is quickly to adapt and learn. Then I just say, let me just enter her this pageant and let's see if she would like it. And then the next thing, she won the first pageant, a national pageant for that matter, without any experience and everything.
Yeah, and my mom was basically my coach. She would give me questions that she would see on the internet, and then we'd practice and go through them, learning how to speak, not saying like or I'm too much during your answers, because that would give you low scores. She has been and still is my rock throughout my whole pageantry career.
If any young hopeful aspiring to a crown needed a fashion godfather, then designer Gerrit Pienaar was Ntando's first choice.
I did my first pageant as S18 ambassador, and he actually dressed me. And from when I won my pageant, he actually reached out to me to say, hey, there's an event, I'd love to dress you. And he actually took me under his wing and even developed my style into what it is today.
And I judge a lot of pageants and I dress a lot of pageant queens. And Ntando just had something that made it stand out. Ntando's style is feminine, classic, sexy, and with a designer twist, there must be something that makes it stand out, especially for pageants.
I feel absolutely incredible in this dress. It's me, it's gold, it's wow, it makes a statement, and that's who I am.
Proud of making her own money as an influencer, she looks every bit the part.
I like the color and the whole trendy corset thing.
Yeah.
And net is very in at the moment. Everybody wants net, but this is like different. It's not just a big fat ball gown. Bit sexy, feminine, but classical.
Hailing from this country, deciding on the color for Ntando's gown was the easy part.
Everyone was sent a list of what we needed to bring to Dubai and all the things that we were going to wear on the different days. But we had so little freedom. But with our evening gowns, they told us that we can do whatever. So we really wanted to come out with a banger.
We decided on gold, and then you'll see there's a lot of movement, and that really draws the eye because soft and flowy, you know, so
this really works well.
It was definitely a showstopper because nobody else thought to do a cape. Everyone else just did either a really big ball gown or just a simple dress like this. And mine was an absolute showstopper because I had movement, I had wind under my wings, and it was absolutely gorgeous.
The impression Miss Sgudla has made on stage and in netball has now seen her appointed ambassador for art, sports, and culture.
My biggest inspiration to even start playing netball has obviously been my mom.
The love of netball, it's been my thing since primary school. Also, I got the full colors, the provincial colors in netball. And at varsity, I was awarded as the netball player of the year. And I'm so glad that even my kids are playing netball and they love it.
It was such an honor to be invited by the Minister of Sports, Arts and Culture to come to the department and for them to honor me and for me to thank them for everything that they've done to support me on my journey to fulfilling my dreams of competing at an international pageant. And it was such a shock for them to even announce me at the end of the meeting as the new ambassador for the Department of Sports, Arts and Culture. So I am so excited about that.
I wish her all the best. I wish that she could stay grounded, stay humble, and always give back, because the most important thing is when you have, try and reach out to those that don't have.
Pulling another sister up when given an opportunity to do so is how Ntando aims to make her success count. An example to all young women. Next up, recording with Sun El musician and 25K, the Ndlovu Youth Choir come of age as singer-songwriters. The Ndlovu Youth Choir's progress over the past 13 years has been a source of pride for many South Africans. They've just launched their second album, Grateful, with their conductor, Ralph Schmidt.
Hey guys, we're here in Braamfontein to record our brand new music video, Africa Hey, with Sunil Musician and Kenza. So what we've tried to represent in this video is the beauty of Africa, the beauty of Johannesburg. You know, the song urges people to go out, and when you travel the world, go and tell people how amazing and how beautiful our continent is. So we're trying to capture the energy of the inner city, but also the beautiful parks around it. And Joburg is just this extraordinary city where you've got this forest in a jungle of concrete. So we wanted to represent that and show the beauty of this amazing city.
Director Bruce Patterson was at the helm and made sure to give the video the kind of homegrown design and texture you can almost feel.
So for today's music video, we're in the CBD in Braamfontein. What we've gone with is just showcasing Africa in the CBD. And so we're working with a lot of textures. We're working with a lot of the building structures, the rooftops, African decor around the CBD, the wardrobes, the costume. If you look at the choir's costume, also very African, very vibrant. Their makeup, same thing. So the look and feel of the video is really just focusing on enriching the African culture and showcasing Africa.
Getting to work with stars like Sunil Musician and Kenza was a true reward for lead chorister Tulisile Masanabo.
So working on this album has been a bit hard due to lockdown. So the album probably took 3 to 4 months to complete. So that was really hectic. And you know, with social distancing, some catching COVID. So we have to wait till everyone is like COVID clear before we can start recording, so that was really, really tough. But nonetheless, we got to engage with each other a lot more in terms of emotions that was put into the song, because it came from a certain place, and like, because we're looking back and reflecting from the days back in AGT and what we've become now. So I'm really grateful for the second album, because we have a lot more original sounds. There are like 3 or 4 original tracks that we put into this album, and most certainly that the sound is very different from what people are normally used to. So I think a lot of people will really like the second album, and they get to engage with us a lot more and like get to feel a sense of our sound.
The choir feel there are so many young people around the world waiting for their chance to show what they can do, that they're proud to represent the potential untapped talents of millions of young citizens of Africa.
Well, people can expect all the normal and Ndlovu joy and soul-stirring harmonies, but I think one thing that's very exciting about this album is we've moved into slightly new genres. For example, we've got a fantastic collaboration with 25K. We've also moved into some electronic music with Sunil Musician, and even dabbled in a bit of Amapiano with Tyler ICU. So we're very excited about that. Another very exciting collaboration is our collaboration with the National Youth Choirs of Great Britain, where we've combined two iconic choral sounds, the sounds of Africa and the traditional European church choir sound.
One thing about our new album is that it's a mixture of many genres, and we have featured many people. In our previous albums, it was just Ndlovu, but currently there are people who we featured, and which is exciting, and we hope our fans are going to love it because we're expressing like a new thing.
The song Grateful tells of young people's hustle to make their family and community proud.
It's been a wonderful creative process seeing the choristers actually start writing. And our title track Grateful was written by Madoda Moshoane, one of our choristers. And we're so excited about that, because to me that kind of represents the next phase of our journey and our growth as Ndlovu Youth Choir. From an after schools program to a performance group, we've always tried to be world class on stage, and now moving into the creative space. So it's been a very fulfilling and a very exciting journey getting to this point.
So what was amazing working on this album was that I actually have a song on the album that I wrote. So the song is amazing. I had to write the verse, I had to write the chorus. And they also told me that we're going to feature an artist, a big artist, and then they said 25K. So I was actually amazed that we're going to work with this big person that has been in the game for some time and he's relevant.
So when I heard the song, it really touched me. And then I was sitting with it for like quite some time until I started putting my story into like pen, paper, wrote it down. And then when I sent back the verse, I was definite that that was gonna be the one, because that was really like my current state of mind in terms of like how grateful I am.
For chorister Luandile Shabalala, the album is a reminder of what comes from giving youth a chance.
What I'm grateful of is the growth. I feel like as the choir, as the Ndlovu Youth Choir, we have grown so much compared to the past few years, and especially me, because when I came here, I had no much experience. But now I can proudly say I can sing, I can do this and that because of Ndlovu. So I am most grateful for the growth.
So the message we really want to convey with this new album is that you should always be grateful for how far you've come. I know the going might be tough, and then, like, obviously we seek to grow and become better and like to express more and like do more in life, but never forget where you come from. It's time to close my eyes up and sleep.
Join us again next week with Pride of African Cuisine, Siba Ntongana, for an evening of fine dining at her new restaurant, Siba. A day out with her husband, Brian Ntongana, and their four gorgeous kids. And a catch-up on how the lady from Mdantane became a global food phenomenon in 150 countries. Get more of the Insider Essay online. Follow, connect, engage, and be inspired to live better with the Insider Essay. Watch the show Monday evenings at 6, repeat Saturday at 1 on S3.